drug discovery for Alzheimer and Parkinson disease. One has to broaden the scope of academic research and make connections, in particular with the pharmaceutical industry. So for this reason, in addition to the Center for Misfolding Diseases, the building hosts the Chemistry of Health Incubator, which is a fairly large space that can host spin-out companies from the department and from the Center for Misfolding Diseases and the Department of Chemistry. And so the first occupant of the incubator is Ren Therapeutics, which is a spin-out company that we founded in 2016, with Thomas and Chris, and then with Sarah Lindsay in Lund, Johnny Hapchke and Sam Cohen. So this company is effectively taking forward towards the clinic the approach that I'm going to describe today, which involves antibodies and site-specific modifications. But I would like to introduce you to the broader picture. So we are using these modified antibodies as tools for drug discovery for protein misfolding disorders, which is what I would like to explain, so our general approach. So the question that we have, that we start with, is how do we stop neurodegeneration? Because protein misfolding and aggregation are associated with this type of disease. So on the sort of medical side, these diseases are, involve the progressive loss of cognitive and functional abilities, and typically progressive, age-related, long-term, slow progression, typically, and still incurable in the large part. On the sort of pathological level, they typically involve the degeneration of brain tissue. So in this slide, I show the, can you see my cursor? So on the left, you see normal brain, on the right, an Alzheimer brain. You see there is a massive loss of brain tissue, in particular in certain specific areas that are vulnerable to the disease, like a hippocampus or the frontal cortex. So at the molecular level, which is where we are looking at and involved in our research, the disease is associated with the presence of certain deposits, which turn out to be mainly formed by proteins. And in the case of Alzheimer, there are amyloid plaques, which is, this is a sort of drawing of neurons, and this white stuff here are amyloid plaques, which are extracellular deposits primarily formed by a protein fragment, which is called amyloid beta, or A-beta for short. And then in Alzheimer, there are also intracellular deposits, which are called tangles, and are formed mainly by another protein, which is called tau, which normally stabilizes microtubules, but then upon impairment of its function, it can aggregate and cause neurotoxicity. So what we know about this disease is that there are aggregates involved at the molecular level. So this is our starting point. So we assume, our hypothesis is that these aggregates are causing the disease, and therefore they are our target for drug discovery. So this is by no means the only possible cause, molecular cause of the disease, but in our view is the most likely one, and therefore the best target for drug discovery. So now the type of protein deposits that we see in Alzheimer is very specific to Alzheimer, but protein aggregation is a more widespread phenomenon. And in fact, there are new diseases that are always identified that are associated with misfolding and aggregation. Currently, there are over 50 such diseases, and they can be brain diseases, neurological like Alzheimer or Parkinson, other forms of dementia, or they can be localized in other organs in the human body, like, you know, it can be type 2 diabetes that tend to kill cancer, pancreatic beta cells, or can be systemic. And so in that case, aggregates are found everywhere. So each disease has its own typical characteristic proteins, and but they are all connected to the by the fact that there is an impairment of the protein homeostasis system and the appearance of these aberrant deposits. So in order to address the problem of developing a drug or a treatment for Alzheimer and other misfolding diseases, one has therefore to ask the question, why aggregates appear in the first place? They shouldn't be there, and so there must be something wrong in the cellular homeostasis system that leads to the formation of these aggregates. So one should look at the protein cycle. So we know very well about these things. We know that proteins are synthesized in the ribosome. They typically undergo a folding process. Here in this case is a secreted protein that is targeted to the ER first and then the Golgi and then is secreted. So this is all well if it works, but we know that it doesn't work all the time. In fact, we know that it doesn't work quite frequently, perhaps one third of the time instead of folding, proteins misfold. So this is a problem because misfolded proteins are not functional. In fact, they can be quite dangerous. So there is a very effective quality control system, which is called protein homeostasis, that identifies these misfolded proteins and directs them towards degradation. In this slide, I show the ubiquitin proteasome system, which is one of the most important degradation pathways. Then there are others, including autophagy. So protein folding is the normal outcome of after protein synthesis, but misfolding happens quite often, and when it happens, it's taken care of very effectively. So this is the most typical situation, but sometimes the quality control can fail. Some misfolded proteins can escape, and then they can get together as misfolded proteins, molecules, and they can form various types of aberrant aggregates, either amorphous, or they can be on pathway to the formation of a particular state of proteins, which is called the amyloid state, in which proteins protein assemblies assume a typical cross beta structure, essentially very long beta sheets and assemblies of beta sheets, which are extremely stable and they shouldn't be there. So again, the quality control system recognizes these aggregates in the various stages of the process of aggregation and eliminates them quite effectively, again, either through the proteasome or through autophagy or through secretion from the cell and so on. So this works very well until we are young, except that with old age, the quality control tends to become impaired, so to lose its effectiveness, and some of the protein aggregates can escape. So this is what we believe is the basic cause of Alzheimer, other dementia and protein misfolding diseases more generally. So we want to supplement the quality control systems with chemicals that achieve the same effect. Effectively, they remove the aggregates or the misfolded proteins. So you may wonder why there is aggregate formation in the first place. And this is a very interesting question. So why would protein would like to aggregate rather than fold? I mean, after all, if you open a textbook in biochemistry, you find that the native state is thermodynamically stable. So proteins shouldn't want to go anywhere else if left to themselves. Well, it turns out that this textual description is not accurate at the cellular concentration of proteins, because the stability of the native state. The native state is the most stable state only under dilute conditions, typically what you do in a lab. So you have a dilute solution of proteins and you see them fold. But in the cell, proteins are highly concentrated, you know, because the cell is a, you know, needs to carry out functions, and therefore the reactants must be concentrated for optimal function. Under these conditions of concentration, intermolecular interactions tend to dominate over intramolecular one, and the amyloid state becomes the most stable one. So the reason why proteins still fold into their native state is not thermodynamics, but is kinetics, because you know the pathway towards folding is favored above the pathway for misfolding aggregation. Therefore, protein fold first, but sooner or later they're able to cross the free energy barrier that separates them from the more stable amyloid state. So if you want, the fact that proteins are functional in their native state is a constant struggle against aggregation, which is where they would like to go. And it's only because we have a protein homeostasis system that, repels that tendency that that we can, live in good health until old age. So this is why it is particularly important to find drugs that help the protein homeostasis system to maintain proteins in the native state. Okay, so we want to, I hope I convinced you that targeting protein aggregation is a convenient strategy, is a promising strategy to treat protein misfolding diseases. So now, when it comes to the specific question, how do we block protein aggregation? You realize that it's not so easy to understand and to find the right strategy. And the reason is that protein aggregation is a complex process. Here it is very schematically, I've indicated it by the fact that there are monomeric proteins as reactants and fibrillar aggregates as products, and in between there is a series of intermediate states, which are called oligomers, of increasing sizes and increasing structure. So somewhere among these aggregates, there are toxic ones, and we know that they are not monomers, the toxic species. We also know that typically they are not the fibrils, which are fairly large and inert. There must be some intermediate states in between. And so the target for drug discovery it starts to narrow down. So it's not the reactant, it's not the reagent, it's some intermediate state in between. So now if we look even in more detail to the aggregation process, we can ask where are the intermediate states or the oligomers coming from? So, and one start drawing on the board possibilities for possible processes leading to this formation. So the most obvious one, you take monomers and you create oligomers or intermediates by some form of primary nucleation. So monomers come together with a certain rate, they form oligomers. And these oligomers can either dissociate or convert into more structured species, small fibrils that can then elongate. So monomers can add to the existing the short fibrils and form longer ones. And then something quite special can happen. So the surface of fibrils can catalyze the formation of new oligomers. Now, if you go back to here on the left, you have monomers coming together through a nucleation process, and which is quite, is quite a slow rate. But then if this same process happens on the surface of the fibrils, it's catalyzed by the surface of the fibrils, and it happens at much faster rate. So now this is a feedback loop that leads to the rapid proliferation of aggregates, because the rate of formation of new oligomers depends on the amount of fibrils present. So the rate of a reaction that is proportional to the abundance of the product is self-replicating, and therefore this leads to the exponential proliferation of the oligom. But you see from this, you know, the scheme is already quite complex, and is certainly, despite being complex, is certainly simplified with respect to what happens in vivo. There may be other processes that contribute to the formation of the oligomers. But even in this simplified scheme, you see that the target is quite difficult because it is simultaneously the protein that you want to target, at the reactants, the products, the intermediates, and the catalysts. So it's not like targeting a protein kinase, which is a catalyst of something. You really don't know a priori what is the state that is most effective in blocking the formation of this intermediate state. In particular, if you want to do traditional drug discovery, you want to select a particular protein in particular conformation. You want to find a drug that binds there, and you want to relate the binding affinity to the efficacy of the drug, to some function that protein carries out. You bind there, you inhibit the function, and then you have a drug, at least in principle. Here, you don't know where to bind in order to stop the oligomer production. So you have to find out where to bind, and this is not easy at all, as I mentioned, because of the multiplicity of roles of the proteins involved as reactants, products, and so on and so forth. So we had, we decided to take another approach, which is we are not going to optimize drug in terms of binding affinity to a particular conformation that we don't know. We are going to develop drugs that alter the aggregation rates. So if, in particular, if we understand which rates of conversion between the different species we want to delay, we can affect the oligomer population. Like, for example, I mentioned that surface catalyzed oligomer formation is particularly effective in producing new oligomers. So it may be that we have to bind fibrils, block the catalytic sites, and in this way we reduce this rate of oligomer formation here. It may be we have to understand better how this kinetic network here of production of oligomer works, and this is what I'm going to explain in the following. Now, I want to take you, hopefully quite quickly, through the three steps that we have conceived in order to address this problem of drug discovery through the minimization of the aggregation rates. So in principle, you don't need three steps, you just need one, because what you want is to minimize the population of oligomers. So the straightforward idea is that you set up a high throughput screening of small molecule in which you monitor the population of oligomers that are produced during the aggregation process. So as a function of time, this is the population of oligomers in the aggregation process. If you can measure this population, you can find by screening libraries of molecules, compounds that are particularly effective in reducing this population here. For example, you can take compounds that reduce this peak here, this red peak here. And then you have a compound that does what you want, reduces the population of oligomers. So it turns out that this step cannot be carried out by any known method currently, because the oligomers are extremely elusive. It's very difficult to measure them. It's not impossible, I'll tell you how to do it, but it's still impossible to do it high throughput. So you cannot screen large libraries of compounds. So you have to take a more convoluted route in which you measure something else, and then you extrapolate from that measurement the information about the oligomers. So this something else is measurement not of the oligomers, which are the intermediate, but the fibrils, which are the product. And then, so you develop a method, a high throughput method to measure the fibrils, and then from the concentration of the products, you extrapolate the concentration of the intermediates in the reaction. And so you know eventually the population of oligomers and their modification upon drug treatment. And then as a final step, a third step, you have to measure the population of oligomers, this time low throughput, because at this point you have done the high throughput screening, you have your few candidates, and you can actually verify that the extrapolation that you have done is correct. So I'll take you through these steps. So the first one, high throughput screening for fibril formation. So this is what typically is the a readout. You know, this is done through fluorescence method. So you have dyes that bind to fibrils and increase the fluorescence. So as a function of time, you monitor the fluorescence. In principle, you can follow the increase in the fibril amount. So in an aggregation reaction, you start from monomers. Here, there is no fluorescence, very little fluorescence because the dye doesn't bind. Then fibrillar species appear, and then you have fluorescence. Now, these experiments are difficult to carry out, but it's possible. It's not for oligomers, which is impossible to carry out. At least here you can carry them out, but still is affected by a large amount of noise. So doing high throughput screening with a large amount of noise is really a recipe for disaster in terms of amount of false positives. So you have to do something better. So, and this is where we started collaborating with Sarah Lins in Lund, who had done, you know, a huge amount of progress in establishing assays, accurate fluorescence assay for the measurement of fibril formation, and we can have very accurate now assays for that. So with this assay, because they are accurate and reproducible, we can not only monitor whether a compound works or not in terms of inhibitory aggregation, but we can be quite detailed in terms of, for example, dose dependence. So this compound, so in black here, you have an unperturbed aggregation reaction. And then when you increasing concentration of your drug candidate, you delay further and further the aggregation process. So you have a sort of dose dependence measurement of the efficacy of a compound. Now, the point is that this takes us to the second step of the process, is that knowing that a compound reduces the amount of fibrils, remember this assay measures the fibrils, not the intermediates, may lead you, so because you say, yeah, I can delay the formation of fibrils, you can naively think that you are also delaying the formation, reducing the population of oligomers. Turns out that this expectation is completely incorrect. In fact, you can think of different scenarios in which, so this is the inhibition of the fibril formation. You see these compounds all inhibit the fibril formation. But if you look at the population of oligomers, you can have any outcome literally. You can increase, decrease, leave unaltered the population of compounds. So you may have a compound paradoxically that delays the fibril formation, but increase the population of oligomers. This compound, if given to a patient, will definitely make the disease worse because it will increase the population of toxic oligomers. So you have to be very careful. You shouldn't be happy too much if you find the compound that delays fibril formation, because you still don't know whether it will increase or decrease the toxicity. So this is why we need really to have a quantitative method to extrapolate from the population of the fibrils, as I said, the products, the population of the oligomers, as I mentioned, the reactants. Now, if you have some experience in chemical reactions, you know that there is a standard tool, which is called chemical kinetics, for extrapolating, so from the knowledge of reactant and products to extrapolate the knowledge of the intermediate. This is called kinetic theory, and is based on the, essentially a series of equations that keep track of the species present, the monomer, fibrils, oligomers. So you can put this population in a mathematical form and also keep track of the rates of conversion. So these equations tell you in a time-dependent manner the population at a given time and how they vary because of the rate of interconversion. So now you start to understand, because you can measure the population of the reactants, the monomer and the products, the fibril, so that you know, and then you can measure the rate of aggregation, all the quantities in this bookkeeping equation are known, except the population of the intermediate species that you can calculate from the equation themselves. So this is a major contribution which was made by Thomas Knowles during his PhD about 15 years ago now. And is the basis, really, together with the aggregation assay that I've explained a minute ago, for our treatment, for our drug discovery pipeline. Because at this point, we can measure all the aggregation rates, and in particular, we can calculate the rate of oligomer formation, which is rather complex expression, but this can be calculated, and it depends on the amount of fibrils, capital M, at a given time, the amount of monomers, small case m, and the rate of the aggregation processes, primary nucleation, secondary nucleation, and so on. So these are all known quantities, measurable quantities, and we can get the rate of formation of oligomers. Now, you understand that this is what we wanted. So we can calculate the amount of oligomers that are produced during a reaction. So we can ask the question from a high throughput assay whether a small molecule is reducing the amount of oligomers that are formed. And so with this, we can not only screen large libraries, but also design derivatives and optimize systematically the heat compounds. So this is what we do in drug discovery. We optimize compounds in this way. But now we are left to the third part of the problem, which is the measurement, the direct measurement of the oligomer population, because we don't want to go ahead in the preclinical development just with a theoretical estimate of the oligomer population, which is what we have at this stage. So it would be rather risky to take forward the drug that we know only by theoretical estimate that reduces the oligomer. We would really like to measure whether in practice reduces the oligomer population. Now, as I said, the oligomers are super difficult as target for measurement because they are transient, they are heterogeneous, they're present in super low amounts, typically sub nanomolar. In any given reaction, and therefore it's not easy to measure them. So for this reason, we use antibodies in a way that similar to what Bruno explained in the initial slide. So we use these proteins to recognize the targets, which in this case are protein oligomers. So how do we, how do we find these antibodies? Well, it turns out that more traditional methods like in vivo or in vitro, say immunization or phage display, are quite challenging for protein oligomers because, as I said, protein oligomers are transient and heterogeneous, so you cannot really have them stable for long enough to apply this method of drug discovery. So what we decided to do instead is to develop computational methods because in that case the oligomers is in the computer, so you can is frozen in time for as long as you need, and in some sense if we do the antibody discovery in the computer, we don't have the problem of the transient nature of the oligomer. And so in order to take forward this idea, of course, this is, doing computational antibody discovery is not the concept, and the methods are around since quite a long time, at least a few, two or three decades, if not more. So, the problem is that it's difficult to implement them. So, the particular way in which we have decided to do that, because we have not a good experience with force fields, molecular mechanics, and molecular simulations. We said we do computational methods, but it's more database-based computational methods. So, so if we have a target, let's say that this is the sequence of the amyloid beta peptide, our target, the peptide is disordered, so we take a stretch of the sequence, like this one indicated, these amino acids indicated in the figure. So that's our target epitope. So we need to find a peptide that binds to this target epitope. And so this this will be our paratope on the antibody. So how do we find this? Well, because, as I said, we don't trust molecular modeling, we do another thing, which is we go in structural databases and we start looking for matching fragments between the epitope and the paratope in existing structures, and not just in existing structure, in existing beta sheet structures. So we take, because typically you don't have the entire epitope and paratope in these databases, we do fragments. Say we take a three residue fragments, say VBT, and then we go into all existing known beta sheets in the protein data bank, and we look when VVT is in a beta sheet with something else. And in this case, it turns out that VVT is paired with SVA. So we take SVA as our first fragment of the paratope, and then we do the same for the remaining fragment. So we mix and match the fragments that exist in nature, and therefore we assume that when we put them back together, they will form a complementary peptide to the target epitope. And then we take this complementary peptide and we graft it onto the CDR loop of a given scaffold. We typically use single domain antibodies because it's just easy to use them. With this fragment-based strategy, we have control on the epitope. So what we do in terms of finding, because remember, we want a conformation-specific antibody for oligomers, except that we don't know the structure of the oligomer. So what we do is we do an antibody scanning method. So now we take the sequence of the A-beta peptide in this case, A-beta is the most toxic form is 42 residues. And so we just design epitopes to cover the entire sequence. In this case, five epitopes are quite sufficient to cover the entire sequence. And then we design five antibodies, one for each epitope. And so in this case, in this way, we can scan the entire sequence of the antibody and we can ask how they affect the aggregation process. Now we can run for each one of the five from the N-terminus to the C-terminus, we can monitor what they do to the aggregation process. So we you know, very reassuringly for the design strategy, all five of them do something to the aggregation process. So design procedure is works all the time in some sense. So the question is, what do the antibody do when they bind the beta peptide? It turns out that they all delay the aggregation process. But as I mentioned, this delay of the aggregation process turns out to have very different consequences on the oligomer population, because the target in the N-terminus of the beta peptide turns out to be very effective in reducing primary nucleation. So the delay that you see here is mostly due to the fact that this antibody here retards the initial formation of the oligomers. But once the aggregates start forming, it's not very effective in reducing the proliferation. This means that it's not very effective in recognizing the oligomers. So this is not going to be very promising for our purpose. Whereas this one towards the C-terminus is incredibly effective in reducing secondary nucleation. So this means that it does something to the oligomer population. So we are going to take this forward for the conformation-specific antibody for the oligomers. But before we do that, I just wanted to mention something that is probably very interesting for you because it's connected to your program, which is we took this antibody, which is very good at retarding primary nucleation. And this is important because if you want to have a preventative drug, for example, for Alzheimer's disease, something, an antibody or a compound in general, that is delaying the onset of the aggregation process can be very helpful. So we asked the question, so if we take this antibody that we designed, and this is formed by 20 natural amino acids, there is nothing strange about it, but we start installing post-translationally, post-production, non-natural side chain. So this is work that has been done by Phil Lindstedt and Ross Taylor, and is in collaboration with Gonzalo. And we found to our great surprise that this antibody, when you start installing non-natural side chain, you can have an absolutely huge effect on the efficacy of the antibody. So by just one modification, we show that you can delay the primary nucleation rate by 5 orders of magnitude. This is an absolutely gigantic effect, which is very reassuring for the type of strategy that you are also pursuing in terms of modifying existing proteins for given purposes. But going back to our oligomer specific antibody, we took this design here, which is highly effective in reducing the oligomers, and we this time we take the epitope and we design 6 different antibodies that have this time the same epitope. So we maintain the epitope and we produce more antibodies for that. And then we do an ELISA measurement. So we measure the binding affinity for the oligomers because we want to optimize this property. And we find that one of them stands out for its ability to bind the oligomers. And then we can ask the question, can we use this antibody to do what we wanted? So to measure the time dependence of the oligomers that are produced during the aggregation reaction. So in this case, I show a compound here. This one is a tool compound that by using a fibril aggregation assay, we show that this is in blue is the unperturbed reaction, in red is the reaction in the presence of the compound. You see that compound delays the aggregation. So that's good, is a good sign, but as you know, it is not yet a guarantee that it will reduce the oligomer population. But now, since we have an antibody that binds the oligomer, we can measure in parallel to this the population of oligomers. So in the unperturbed reaction, you see that there is a peak in the oligomer population because initially you have no oligomers, it's all monomer, and in the end you have no oligomers because it's all fibrils. But in the middle, you have a large population because this is where fibrils are starting to grow. So this is in the absence of the compound, and if you add the compound, you delay the fibril formation, but most importantly, you reduce the amount of oligomers that are produced. So this is a direct readout. So as I said, we cannot use this high throughput, but once we have a promising compound, we can use it to test it. And then we can also go on and show that we can do the similar measurements, not just in an in vitro reaction, but in a living organism. And well, not leaving because we have to, analyze the lysates in this particular experiment. But we can measure the effect, whether the potency of a treatment by measuring the amount of oligomers in a disease model. And with this, I want to finish the presentation by thanking my collaborators. I mentioned Chris Dobson, Thomas Knowles, Sarah Lindsay, Sam Coy, and John Hapke. With whom I've established the drug discovery program. Gonzalo has recently joined our efforts and a series of very talented PhD and postdocs. A large number at the Center for Misfolding Diseases. I only listed here those that have more directly contributed to the work that I've presented today. So with this, I finish, and I would really like to answer your question if you have any.
Okay, right. Thank you, Michel. Great work, amazing. We are now going for a Q&A session, okay? But before going to discussion, I would like to let you know that we are recording the lecture. So please, if you have any concerns in terms of privacy, please you know, take care with your image and voice. And just one comment, what really fascinates me is how using just a very simple method. So the tendency is usually to go for very expensive computational studies to identify proteins or compounds that bind proteins. And in your case, it's just very simple using the X-ray structures that are available. You can just select a peptide sequence for your epitope. And this is just incredible. Saying that, I would like to probably start the discussion and kind of to break a bit the ice. And as you know, I'm not an expert on protein aggregation. We have some experts on the audience. Maybe they will come with some questions related with aggregation, protein aggregation. I would like just to ask you, the method that you are using for identification of antibodies can be applied to any other target, or it's only, do you know if it works well with other targets, or at the moment it's only working for the detection of oligomers?
No, that's a great question. Of course, you know, we are developing the methods also for other targets, in particular for targets that have been challenging for traditional methods. For example, ion channels, you know, because they have resisted to most attempts so far, we are very keen to work on those. I don't have results yet on that, but it's certainly in our mind and plans.
Okay. So what I realized is that for targeting the oligomers, you have you run a series of softwares that allow you to calculate the accessible solvent accessible sequence on your target epitope, and also you also I think it's I forgot the name of the softwares, I'm really sorry, but then you also have a software that identifies the disorder sequence of the target protein. The strategy is the same, or if you want to just identify antibody for other targets, the method is quite different.
Yes, now the strategy that I've explained is very specific to protein aggregation, because as I mentioned, the product of the reaction is a cross beta structure. So effectively, long filaments made up of beta sheets. So the most important interaction is hydrogen bonding, as you find in beta sheets. So we are designing our antibodies to bind the target exactly to the same type of interaction. So in that sense, we are interested in looking at fragments that, as I mentioned, do beta sheets in the protein database. But that's, if you have a different target, you may look for different type of interactions between fragments in order to choose the fragments that are most suitable for binding your target. So the strategy is flexible. So the concept of taking fragments from databases is general. The implementation is target specific, and it depends on the type of interactions that you want to you believe are most important.
Okay, great. So moving forward, I have two questions from the audience. Claudio, could you please?
Yes, hello. Hi, everybody. Hi, Michele, great talk. Fascinating work as always. I would like to hear your comments on the possibility that, these oligomers are really important players in the process. But as there is also this discussion on its intrinsic heterogeneity. So I would like you to comment on if you see that these different antibodies that you are designing might be able to contribute to discriminate between different subtypes of oligomers, or if you think that under some conditions you will have a preferred type of oligomers than the other?
Yeah, that's a great question, Claudio. This scanning that I presented, I presented it for, in the case of, I call it sequence scanning because the epitopes are aligned along the sequence, mm-hmm. but you can do a surface scanning. So you can design antibodies to cover the surface of an existing antigen, for example, amyloid fibers. Mm. You don't know the structure of the oligomer, so you cannot do the surface scanning for the oligomer. But what we have done is we have extrapolated the surface scanning to studying the structure of oligomers. So the concept is that you don't know the structure of the oligomers, but if there are different oligomers, they will expose different regions of the sequence of A beta. So if we take oligomers of a certain type and we do a fingerprint, so we see which antibodies bind in this panel of five, we have a surface mapping of those. So we don't know the structure, but we know that antibodies 1, 3, and 5 bind it. So that's a fingerprint. And then we produce oligomers in another way, and we find that the bound by 3, 4, and 5, so they are clearly different. So we don't know exactly what's the structure, but we know that they are different. And then, in fact, we have done this. So we have coupled this scanning with toxicity measurements. So, for example, you can show that oligomers that disrupt lipid membranes have a different fingerprint from oligomers that bind immune receptors. So we can do this type of studies. So these antibody panels that are obtained through scanning, either sequence or surface, can be used as research tools to characterize the structural differences between these oligomers.
If I'm allowed a quick follow-up question, which is a kind of a provocation, you think that any of these will evolve into some type of tool that will allow us to quantitate oligomers? Because this is currently, in my view, one of the big challenges, because the direct quantitation is obviously implemented, as you showed, tricky.
Let me go back. So this is one example of a quantitative mm-hmm. measurement of the oligomer. So this signal, which is the binding of the conformation-specific antibody to the oligomers, is taken over an aggregation reaction. So you really have a time dependence of the oligomer population. And it's quantitative in the sense that the oligomer population that you extrapolate in the way I've explained corresponds exactly, or not exactly, but within errors to the population that you can actually measure. Now the trick, is that this is, quite difficult to do, and so what we are working on is to make making these measurements fully repeatable in our hands, in the hands of any other group that want to use it. I mean, it's a lot of work, as you know. Antibody working with antibodies is always
Antibodies and A beta, that's probably the worst combination ever.
Reproducibility is difficult to achieve, but we are certainly. We have evidence that this approach can be quantitative in terms of oligomer measurements, and we are working on its sort of industrial level repeatability.
Thank you.
Okay. So, Mar, you raised your hand. I don't know if you want to make any question.
Maybe I can ask. Thanks, Michele, for the great lecture about what you do in the lab. I have a very basic naive question. And so why do the aggregates or the misfolded proteins survive with long age? Is it because the cellular machinery for recognition and degradation is downregulated in first place, or is it just a matter of numbers that they start accumulating with time and age? And also kind of linked to that, how do they end up in the extracellular space? Are they exported or just released by the cell when it dies?
No, these are all great questions. And, in fact, You know, people have been asking these questions for the last 3 decades, and we know some of it, but not a lot. I mean, your last question is quite well known, although maybe the answer is very partial. The A-beta peptide is a protein fragment which is cleaved by secretases and is cleaved directly into the extracellular space. So it's the obvious idea is that is produced in the extracellular space already, and this is where you find amyloid plaques there. Now, the story may be a bit more complicated because it can be produced also during the secretion pathway. And you know, what I'm trying to say is that you can you have a basic answer to some of your questions, and the true answer may be a lot more complicated. In terms of why we tend to accumulate protein aggregates with age, I think, again, there are fairly simple explanations, like, I don't know, you can have a familial mutation in the degradation pathway. Therefore, I mean, at some point, this shows up. So increases your vulnerability to the impairment of the degradation pathway. Usually is a multiple hit situation in which you need. I wouldn't say necessarily is in cancer. So you need an accumulation of problems in order to see a phenotype, but it may be something close to that. So what I'm saying is that if you think about the complexity of the protein, the cellular homeostasis system, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of components. So an accumulation of damage or impairment in a small number of them, and it can be many different types, will eventually lead to the accumulation of the aggregates or one sort of another in one cell type or another in one tissue or another. So Mar, this is a great question, and the answer is can be as long as you want, but we can talk much more if you are interested about this.
Thanks, Michele.
Okay, I think we still have time for one more question, please. So Mike, can you go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, thanks for the great talk. I was curious about the part of your talk where the antibodies have a background effect on the kinetics of oligomerization. I was curious to know if you'd thought about or tried just short peptides that display those same sequences to see if that has an effect, or if you can subtract the background that might be due to the antibody.
So I'm not sure I understand the question. Are you asking me if you need to graft the peptides onto an antibody to see an effect?
I was curious if you could just treat with those peptides alone.
Yes. No, that's a great question. We haven't tried the peptide themselves, but we have tried different scaffolds. For example, we have produced bicyclic peptides, which is, which is the absolute minimum in terms of scaffold. So we tried bicyclic peptides. Turns out, or we tried full-length antibodies on the other range, or we have tried other type of antibody-like scaffolds. Turns out that this single domain antibodies are the correct size and shape to interfere with the aggregation process optimally. But, we don't know yet which is the best form of this complementary peptide. We tend to, I don't know, I think peptides as such are a bit difficult in terms of, dealing with them. And so they tend to aggregate and be degraded. They have a few problems. So we tend to look for scaffolds to host them. But you are right. It may be that in some cases, just taking the peptide as such is the best option.
Thank you.
Okay. So I think this is it for today. We don't have any other questions. I would like to once again thank you, Michel, for presenting your work today. and also to thank everyone for attending this seminar, and see you soon, and bye-bye to everyone.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.